Coming up on today's show.
With refuse, reduce, reuse, repurpose, recycle. Okay. And the theory behind that is when you start at the top with refuse, you're actually doing the most good. Okay. And then you work your way down to recycle. But I think people are most familiar with reduce, reuse, recycle.
Okay. Now, is reducing also something like decluttering?
Sure.
Would you put that in the same category?
I would.
So that's a whole concept of just trying to minimize, get things taken away, throw away, give away.
Yes.
I suppose there's got to be like some kind of three-letter acronym for that.
I'll make one up tonight, John.
Okay. The five R's of eco-friendly organizing. Today on Keeping You Organized. Hello and welcome to Keeping You Organized. Today we are going to go green. We are going to look at the five R's of eco-friendly organizing. Now, I only thought there were three, so we have to get a little deeper into this with Tammy Shotsko. Welcome back to Keeping You Organized.
Thank you for having me.
And your website, so people know how to get a hold of you, is?
WeLoveMesses.com.
Okay, WeLoveMesses.com. All right, well, we're going to talk about eco-friendly organizing today.
Good.
And now, I thought there were only these three R's of, what is it? Reuse, recycle, repurpose?
Reduce, reuse, recycle are the three basic ones.
Okay, now, but there's two more now, huh?
Just to confuse us.
Okay.
No, not really to confuse us. They have added refuse and reduce.
Okay, well, let's take them. Is there a particular order that they maybe would make sense in talking about?
Well, I think they start at the top with refuse, reduce, reuse, repurpose, recycle.
Okay.
And the theory behind that is when you start at the top with refuse, you're actually doing the most good.
Okay.
And then you work your way down to recycle. But I think people are most familiar with reduce, reuse, recycle.
Okay, well, let's start with number one.
Okay.
The first R of the five R's, and we'll get a little background to why it's important.
Okay, refusing. Basically, that gives you the option to say, no, thank you. I don't want it, need it, use it, love it. Okay. If I come to you and say, hey, I've got some extra shirts that I just cleaned out of my closet. Do you want them? They're free.
Of course. Anything free,
see,
I want, right?
There you go, right there.
Am I supposed to tell you no? Then
yes.
What are you going to do with them?
I'm going to give them to the Goodwill.
Okay.
Or find someone who needs them.
Okay. Yeah, I think we get caught in those situations a lot,
yes,
too, don't we?
Yes. Or you go to an expo or a fair and you get the little goodie bag and you go around, you get all the good free stuff. I can't tell you how many thousands of unsharpened pencils I've seen at clients' homes.
Yes. So what are some of the tactics and tips that we can use to overcome that? Is it as simple as just saying no?
No, thank you.
No, thank you. Okay, well, at least we can be proper about it,
thanks
right?
Thanks for thinking of me, but no, thank you.
Okay. That's it?
That's as simple as that?
I mean, there's no mindset? There's nothing you have to...
Well, there's the mindset behind you have to cycle it through. Do I want that?
Right.
Do I have a place for it? Do I have somewhere I can put it? And if the answers to that are no, why would you want to take it home?
Right. Or is there like even a qualifier? Like, you can't just say no to everything. Is it say, will I use this in the next 30 days?
Do I use it? Do I love it? Yep.
Okay. Yep. All right. So that one's like fairly easy to cover.
It is.
It's
still a different way for thinking, though, because most of us just automatically say yes.
Yeah.
You say the word free? Yes.
Of course, we love free. Free
we
is a good
free.
Thing,
yes.
Right? It's one of the strongest words. Yes, yes. Okay.
No.
So we are going to say no, right?
We are going to say no. We are going to refuse politely.
Okay. So let's get into the second R then.
Okay. That would be reduce.
Okay.
That would be kind of
is that reduce the number of times you say no?
No.
No.
Okay. That would be like reducing your junk mail.
Okay.
Do you get a lot of junk mail?
I get a lot of junk mail, yes.
There's great things. Have you ever heard of the Paper Karma app?
No, I haven't.
Beautiful. It's free. You use it on your smartphone, whatever. And I'm not very technologically advanced. If I can use it, I promise you can. And it's paperkarma.com. You download it. You take a picture of your junk mail.
Yeah.
And enter your address just one time, and it unsubscribes you.
No kidding.
No kidding.
Oh, that is.
And you just snap a picture every time you get a piece of junk mail, and it automatically sends it to the big cloud in the sky and unsubscribes you.
Wow, paperkarma.com. We'll have that in the show notes
because
I think that's going to be.
It is a wonderful app, and it's really not hard to use.
Now, is reducing also something like decluttering? Would you put that in the same category?
I would.
So that's a whole concept of just trying to minimize, get things taken away, throw away, give away. I suppose there's got to be like some kind of three-letter acronym for that.
I'll make one up tonight, John.
Okay.
I think as an organizer, maybe the people who came up with the five R's didn't necessarily look at it from that concept, but I look at reduce as part of, as reducing our clutter as part of the five R's.
Right. Now, part of that also, and I'm sure we're going to cover, is when you reduce, you want to ecologically take yes. care of what you're reducing. You just yes. want to throw everything away, right?
No, I, as an eco-friendly organizer, like to have resources for my clients.
Okay.
And I will find, it depends on the client. If you have a client who has a lot of stuff and they're very stuck on finding the exact right home for mm-hmm. it so it doesn't go in the landfill, whether that's recycling or giving it to someone or things like that, but they're also facing perhaps a deadline where mm-hmm. they have to get the house or their space cleaned up or there's going to be a third party coming in, mm-hmm. you have to walk that line between throwing it in the landfill and finding the perfect home and try to kind of do a little bit of both. Does that kind of make
yeah,
sense?
Yeah, it does. What do you think is the most unique thing that you've ever had someone recycle, you know, in your clients? Because there's probably a lot of things that people don't know that they can recycle that, yes. oh, okay.
You know. Eyeglasses?
Okay.
I mean, that's not outstandingly odd.
How do you recycle
those? The Lions
those?
Club actually has donation boxes all okay. around. Usually optical shops will have it where you can okay. drop them there. And then I believe, I don't know exactly what the Lions okay. does with them, but I think they take them overseas yeah. and fit them to needy people over there.
Wow. Well, and do you think there has been a kind of a surge in these secondhand stores? The,
yes.
the Goodwills, of course,
yes.
have been around a while,
yes.
but it seems like there's a thrift store
everywhere.
On every corner.
Yes, I noticed one coming in too, and I'm like, yeah, they're everywhere.
Yeah.
And that's the other thing I tell people too, with there's thrift stores and then there's consignment stores.
Okay.
And people oftentimes think that because they've spent money on a good item that they're going to return that money to their
okay.
pocket by selling it. And the problem I see is that there's such a glut coming into the market of
right.
secondhand stuff that the finances don't return to you.
Right. Now, you know, I know you're a shopper. Have you ever just thought of this? When you go, when you go out and you go into these stores and there's like hundreds and hundreds of, like, let's say a shoe store, for example, because we were talking about that
before. We were talking
yes.
about that.
There is like thousands of pairs of shoes in like every shoe store.
Yes.
But I guess there's billions of people, right? So just the shoes alone. I mean, now, do you have any rules for how you recycle shoes? Or are you only allowed to have a certain number of pairs in your closet before you have to say, you know what, it's time to move them out?
Usually I say your space gets to dictate what you have.
Okay.
But you have to listen to what I say, not as I do. No, I'm kidding. you know, there actually is a place you can recycle shoes. Earth911.com has a listing of all the different places you can recycle things. And I think the organizers through NAPO has, it's called Souls for Souls.
Oh.
And they actually collect the shoes and then
nice.
Do something with them. But I'm not exactly sure what they do.
Right. Well, and just the... There's just that one category
yep.
of clothing is just a huge category.
It is. So
now we've I've already forgotten what the first two R's
refuse
are.
Refuse and
okay,
reduce.
Okay, refuse and reduce. Now what's number three?
Reuse, which
okay.
a lot of people know. That is like reusing your grocery bags, if you get
okay.
grocery bags, for garbage can liners.
Okay.
Or one of my favorite things is, you know, using the cloth bags, carrying the cloth bags with you, or using your coffee cup, taking
mm-hmm.
your coffee cup with you wherever you go.
Yep.
You're reducing and reusing.
I know a lot of stores also, too, will incentivize you to
yes.
you bring your own bag
yep.
and they'll give you 5 cents off or
yep.
whatever, and that can
yep.
really add up, too.
I think
as,
so.
And it's just a good practice as well.
Yeah.
So are there any other... resources or organizations or things that come to mind for you as far as helping you to learn ways to reuse things that maybe you don't think you can reuse?
Well, you know, Pinterest is kind of a
yeah.
beast of its own, and there are gazillions of good ideas on there for both reusing and repurposing
okay.
things. And I just think out of the box. Just because you brought something home that maybe is a table, this could be many different things
yes.
if you just think about how you need to use it.
Right.
And I think people get stuck in, it's a table.
Right.
It can only be a table, but
yeah.
it could be...
Okay, I'm going to ask you another one of those wild
okay.
questions
okay.
about clients and maybe the most unique thing that has been, you know, reused, repurposed is another term, I guess, right?
I actually have a client who repurposed a vintage train case, like the old-fashioned train cases. Do you know what I'm talking
no,
about?
No, I don't.
Like an old-fashioned suitcase.
Oh, suitcase, okay,
to,
yeah,
train
right,
case,
right.
They call them a train case, into a stool. She had a little legs, like three legs, like the tripods for the camera.
Yeah.
It is adorable.
Wow.
Now, it wouldn't work in everybody's house.
No, and you have to kind of...
yeah.
Well, I've also heard stories of people that were someone really, and you probably can relate to this as an organizer, working with a client who maybe just can't get rid of something. Mm-hmm. So you have to be kind of creative and how can we reuse that in a different way, right?
Or display it in a way that honors its memory. If they're not parting with it because it has some kind of memory attached to it, we have to figure out how to display that so that they can have a presence around them.
Have you any unique ideas that you've seen on that, on reusing that?
Well, like kids' artwork is a lot of times things that people come to me with because it's hard to let go because you kind of feel like you're letting go of their childhood, but you're not, you know. And I talk about having a picture of the kid taken with the artwork or storing it under the bed and having the child at the end of the school year choose their most favorite pieces and only keeping several from the year, or having a way to cycle it through. So maybe this week, this is the art on the refrigerator. Next week, if you bring home three more pieces, you have to decide, does the one on the refrigerator go or do you choose one of the other ones to go? And that actually helps children learn to make decisions when they're kind of inconsequential. I mean, it's very important at the time, but I think we need to learn how to make decisions again too, and it's hard.
Yeah,
it's very hard.
Well, I know my younger daughter loves to draw pictures, so, but there's hundreds of them.
Yes.
And each one is special.
Absolutely.
And you say, how can you let that go? So a lot of times what we'll do is we'll take one of those picture frame art holders and just put it in for a little bit, and a couple weeks later put a different one in, and then that way, you know, you at least have them on display.
Yeah. And you've honored her work. And I think that makes them feel special too.
Okay. Well, we're going to take a quick little break here. And when we come back, we'll get the other two R's. We're talking about the five R's of eco-friendly organizing with Tammy Shotsko. And we'll be right back.
Are you looking to get your office organized but don't know where to start? And what can you really do to keep your office organized? Smead has put together a new ebook to help you answer these exact questions. We've compiled the best tips from professional organizers around the country to help you tackle the most common office organizing challenges. Go to smead.com/office organization and get your free copy today. That's smead.com/office organization. The new Organization for the Office ebook from Smead, keeping you organized.
We are back now on Keeping You Organized, talking about the five R's of eco-friendly organizing. Now, there used to be three, and now there's five, so we're kind of, and we're not doing that to make the show any longer. Tammy, let's, for those who maybe fell asleep during the first half, let's recap the first three that we covered already.
Refuse, reduce, reuse, repurpose, and recycle is the five.
Okay, so we already did the first three.
Yep.
Number four.
Repurpose, which again, we're right back to Pinterest. That is a huge, it's both a blessing and a curse.
Right.
Because all of a sudden you're surrounded with all these fabulous ideas, but we have to weigh that with, are you actually gonna do that?
Right. And now, wouldn't reuse and repurpose be similar?
They're very similar. They're very similar.
I guess reuse is using it for the same purpose it has before, right? Repurpose is more using it for, and we kind of touched on that before, using it for a different purpose, but
it's like splitting hairs a little bit.
Okay.
But my favorite example for repurposing that seems pretty easy to comprehend is the Glade and Febreze candles you can buy in a glass jar.
Okay,
when the candle's gone, you have a glass jar. And they're kind of a nice size.
Uh-huh.
They're great for Q-tips, cotton balls, pen jars.
Right.
I use them all over the house for different things.
Right. And I know a lot of people will use like canning jars
for
just regular drinking glasses
and
things like that. What are some of the other things that you've seen that people have repurposed?
Well, again, we talked about the shopping, the the shopping bags used in the garbage cans.
Right.
I think that's a great opportunity to reuse something or repurpose it. I'm just trying to think of course I'm drawing a blank because you're asking me directly about repurposing.
Maybe I should repurpose the question, right?
Yes, please do.
Are there other, and we talked about Pinterest before, are there other ways that you get inspired to kind of have people repurpose items?
All the time. And when we're in a house working, for example, I had a client the other day who we were talking about what to use, what do you put your utensils in if you want them right by the stove? She had a beautiful stoneware pitcher sitting in a cupboard somewhere that no one saw, and she brought it out, put it next to the stove, and put the utensils in there that she used for cooking. It was beautiful.
Okay.
So she got a double benefit. You get to see this beautiful pitcher that she has, and it's functional as well.
Yeah, and a lot of those, I know we have something like that. It's something that came from Sweden. You know, you probably wouldn't use it every day.
Right.
But it's kind of, but it makes a nice flower vase.
Yes, exactly. So things like that.
There's ways to do that. Okay, so we've repurposed now. What's the last thing that we want to get?
Recycling, and that's what everybody thinks about. And recycling is a good thing, but according to the people that developed the five R's, starting at the top with refusing actually taking the item in, and working your way down is actually the best way to go. But of course, we want to recycle. We want to recycle our paper and our plastic and our metal and our electronics and things like that. And I think metro areas tend to lend themselves better to that than rural areas. Like, you know, I'm from a rural area. We have a tough time doing anything but paper and plastic, really. But you come down to the metro area and Best Buy takes cords. They take gift cards. They have, as you come into the store, they have slots for all those things that you can just drop. So I bring down cords, like cell phone cords, extension cords, you know, things that clients are getting rid of or can't use, and I'll drop them in their bins.
Now, do you know what any of those are being reused or recycled for?
It is on one of my list of things. Like, my bucket list is sadly about that kind of stuff.
How would that stuff go?
And you know what else I want to know is the grocery stores take back the bags, but I don't know what they do with them. So.
Well, and I've there is a furniture company in Minnesota that takes recycled milk jugs and makes furniture out of them.
Love it, like, and the outdoor furniture.
Yeah, and they're and they're real durable. They last forever, but it's a great eco-friendly tip.
Absolutely,
and a great way to reuse it. And you know, it's not filling up a landfill somewhere.
Absolutely.
Any stats or figures that you have that would be shocking enough to inspire someone to recycle?
I think really all you have to do is Google land mass or garbage mass in the ocean, and there is a floating mass actually in the ocean of plastic and stuff. Yeah. That, to me, seeing that is just enough to realize that we have too much stuff.
Yeah, I know recently when they were looking for some of the debris from the crashed airliner that they would get confused because there's all, and you think, well, gosh, I don't ever remember seeing garbage in the ocean, but I guess that's a really big issue.
The ocean's a big place.
Yeah, it is a big place, and there's a lot of it out there.
Yeah.
Okay, so we've covered the five R's. Is there any other parting advice that you'd have for people as far as how to just be more eco-friendly? Are there other things that you use in your own life or in your clients that you recommend that are just more eco-friendly than than normal?
I really work to try to find companies that are committed to the environment. If I'm going to purchase something large or make a commitment to something that's going to live in my home for a while, usually that's a big financial investment. I try to make some, do some research and find the companies that are committed to doing environmentally safe practices. Smead obviously offers recycled products. That's a big thing when I'm doing file systems for people. We often look into that. And just in general, as an organizer, I bring to the clients a list in of resources of nonprofits, charities, companies that are looking for certain items that perhaps the clients are getting rid of. For example, the homeless shelter takes blankets. The domestic abuse nonprofit takes those little shampoo bottles that we all get from the hotels and have probably mass quantities in our bathroom. If they can go to someone else, it's much easier to let go of something that you know is being used by someone in need.
Well, I like you say, some people just don't know all the different things
they
can do. And if everybody did a little bit more, it would make a pretty big impact.
You think taking your cup to Starbucks and getting your coffee is not that big of a deal, but on a daily basis, if you think about how often you go, how many paper cups you throw away, it really does make a big impact, just little bits. I think Kermit the Frog says it's hard being green, but I think we try too hard. We can do little things. No, we're not going to save the planet, but we can do something.
Right. That's great. Great advice. Before we go, I just want to give you the opportunity to talk about We Love Messes. That's your business.
And
WeLoveMesses.com. Now, you are in rural Minnesota, but do you do services in a, an expanded area? Tell us about...
I serve most of northern Minnesota.
Okay.
I'm fully happy to travel to the cities. Although there are
Especially because there's a lot of shoe stores down
here. Yes, there are a lot of shoe stores down here. Yeah. There's wonderful organizers down here as well, too. But I offer virtual services and hands-on organizing. I love working with hoarders and chronic disorganization, but I'll do either or.
Okay. And is your website the best way for people to get a hold of you?
Yep. I also do Facebook. And on my website, I do write a blog every Thursday. And I try to do things like all of April. Now I'll be doing eco-friendly organizing. And I do try to post things that I've run across that are like simple little tips. Just because I think one step at a time, one little thing.
Great. Well, definitely, we hope people aren't going to throw this show away because it's full of great tips. We'll have
thank
our show notes at smead.com/podcast. Tammy, thanks again. And have you back again another time.
Wonderful. Thank you.
All right. There you have the five R's of eco-friendly organizing. Go out and implement them. It'll make a difference.
It will.
And we'll see you next time on Keeping You Organized.
coming up next time on Keeping You Organized.
There are a lot of studies that are showing that people are overwhelmed and with clutter, of course. The first symptom that a lot of people experience with stress and depression is feeling overwhelmed.